Thank you. I want to thank the organizers for the invitation. It's been a great week. So this is joint work with Jairo Bocchi and Rafael Potri. Okay, so just so we know we're talking about the same thing, let me recall the classical Moore's lemma. So when you have a negatively curved space, you have some quasi-geodesic. So provided the quasi-geodesic is long enough, it's going to be a bounded distance from a true geodesic. Right? This is the classical Moore's lemma negative curvature. So this is obviously false when you look at flats, right? Because when you're in R2, some spiraling thing is actually a quasi-geodesic, right? So it turns out that recently, Kapovich, Ivan Porti in 2014, I think. So they stated, they proved a very nice version of the Moore's lemma for symmetric spaces of higher rank. So symmetric spaces of semi-simple groups of non-compact type. So what we did with Jairo and Rafael, so we actually found a new proof of their theorem. We believe this is essentially a different proof, so this is what I would like to talk about. So I'm going to actually talk about the proof of the state of the theorem and not why it is important or why is this relevant. So the actual statement requires some knowledge of the symmetric space. So the statement is going to come later in the talk, not at the beginning. So let me start by saying, by explaining the main tool we're going to use. This is called the what's called dominated splittings. So what is this? So when you have some fiber bundle over some compact base, and you have some bundle of automorphism, so this is some, so this is linear on fibers, and this is over some dynamics on the base. So T here could be discrete time or continuous time, could be a flow or could be. So we say that it has a dominated splitting. If well, the bundle splits into two continuous invariant sub-bundles. And what else? So we're going to ask some conditions. So which is vectors here are contracted more than vectors here. Okay. So this is some sort of very weak condition in some sense. So I'm not requiring that vectors actually contract. They could both be contracting, or they could both be expanding. I'm just saying that here goes is contracting more than here. So let's put it this way. Okay, so if I pick a vector on E, if I pick any vector on E and any vector on F, if I flow long enough, so this gets smaller. Okay. So this is actually equivalent, this looks very strong, but it's actually equivalent. So actually just the limit going to zero. So this is what I'm saying. So these vectors here are contracted more than vectors here. That's it. So the basic example of this is when you have some sort of an also some hyperbolic dynamics or geodesic flow, something negatively curved. This is actually what's called hyperbolic, which is this is contracted and this is expanded. Right? Also, this comes in the family of what's called the weaker versions of hyperbolicity. So, for example, that was one example of the dominated splitting. Another example, which we're not going to use, but I could just state it like that, so that. Here what we're talking about. So if you have some representation of some hyperbolic group into PSL DR, say, so this is going to be an also, in the sense of Francois, if and only if the associated flat bundle has a dominate explicit. Okay, so this is another characterization of being an anisotropic representation in the sense of Francois. If you don't know what this means, it doesn't matter, we're not going to use it. Okay, so what I'm going to try to use now is there is a very nice characterization of having a dominate splitting like this, which is due to Bocchi and Grumelon. So let me introduce some notation. So when you have if you have some map going from some linear map, between two norm vector spaces, we're going to call sigma 1 of A these are called the singular values. Yeah, so this is what is this? So your matrix A takes a ball and sends it into some ellipsoid. So these singular values are just the size of the axis of this, the image ellipsis, right? And let me just introduce another notation, which is I'm gonna look at here. So for example, if say the p's singular value is greater strictly than the p plus one, for example, if you have some sort of gap between singular values, then we're gonna denote by UP, say, of A, which is the vector space defined by the first P axis of the ellipse. By the greatest P. Yeah. Metric spaces, yeah. Metric inner product of V and inner product on W. Yeah. So what is the characterization that Bocchi and Grumelon found? It's actually nice. W. It's on the image. Yeah, so thank you for. So we're going to also consider like the image of this, the pre-image of the smallest axis. The pre-image is like this. And here we're gonna have some other space. We're gonna call it SD minus P of A. So the statement, is the following. So you have some automorphism, some linear automorphism of some vector bundle. Then it has a dominated splitting. Say of dimension p. Say for example that one of them has dimension p. If and only if, when you look at the p plus one singular value of your matrix, of your automorphism, and you divide by the p, the p one, this is contracting. Okay, so if you have some gap on the singular values up to time t, that is contracting with t, right? Then you will find some dominated splitting. You will find some invariant sub-bundles. So the straight direction is actually forward. There's nothing to do. It is the backwards direction that's a little harder. And so let me just say a few words about the proof. So what they do is they actually find who the splitting is going to be. So you want to find a splitting like this, right? An invariant splitting. So how do they find it? Actually, they show the following. So you want to take this u, p, say, of psi t into the time minus t. Okay, so this is some vector that's living on the fiber over x, right? I go backwards t times, and I look how this map expands the first p vectors, and I look at what I get. This is what this is. Some ellipse, some ball here. Look at the image here. It's going to give you some ellipse. And you want to look at the biggest p-axis of the ellipse. So what they show is that this is convergent, and the limiting is going to be some invariant bundle. So to show that this is convergent, it's not actually very hard. Some tricky computations, some very clever computations using this actually give you that this is a Cauchy sequence, that's actually the distance in t is decreasing exponentially on t. So this is actually easy. The problem, what's hard is when you look at the other guys. If you want to find the other one, you're going to look at the other space that's standing here, where it contracts the most through the past. And what they show, okay, this is also conversion, just because of the same. But the hard part to show is that these guys are in direct sum. That these guys actually don't intersect. So this is the non-trivial input of the statement. And what they do is they use some old machinery, which is called Osele-Detz theorem, which is actually a measurable theorem. So in some sense, using some measurable theorem from the 60s called the Osele-Detz, they can show that this is true almost everywhere for any invariant measure. That's always true for every point. Something like that. Some standard argument like that. Okay, so let me explain. Let me know. We're going to leave that theorem there, and we're going to come back to it like in half an hour or so. And let me say something about symmetric spaces. Let me just always stay in SLDR so it's simpler. If we have time, we can say something about the general case afterwards. But let me explain something about the symmetric space of SLD. So this is going to be very basic so that everybody follows. So what are we going to do? We're going to define the symmetric space. We're going to consider the space of inner products on RD. Up to homotopy. Okay, so this is going to be our space. It's just a point here is an inner product up to homotopy. So this is a contractible space, of course. It's a convex space, convex set of some vector space. So this guy has some action, right? So SLD acts here, or PSLD acts here. So it acts transitively. So this will give you some way, for example, to understand what is the tangent space to this guy. Yeah, so for example, if you pick some inner product up to homotopy, then this induces some involution on the Lie algebra, right? Just the adjoint involution, transpose involution, right? So this involution splits the vector space into eigenvectors and vectors that are sent to its opposite. So this is E. This is eigenvectors. Okay, so this is very simple. So it turns out that, okay, so this is what? This is the Lie algebra of the compact group stabilizing O. So E, this is some compact group stabilizing O. And the other is what? So the other is just the set, just the space. Matrices, diagonalizable on a O orthogonal set. Okay, so this gives you the tangent space to this guy just because you have XD. Here you have some point. This is acting here, KO. The derivative of the stabilizer of this point, so this goes to zero, and PO goes through the tangent space. And so the thing is that here is SLDR, and you have this, you have the Killing form. This is what? The Killing form of AB is simply the trace of AB. Okay, so this is very silly, but if you consider some metric which is actually on P, so if this matrix is diagonalizable, so this trace is just the sum of the eigenvalues, right? So this is just a sum. So in particular, but this is positive definite and not a generator, of course, right? So the metric on the symmetric space, the Riemannian metric we're going to choose is the scaling form restricted to this space. So in some sense, the metric isn't changing. What's changing is the space where you measure. So it turns out, okay, so you have some point. Say you have some point on XD, and you have some tangent vector. This is just PO. Yeah? So this is what? This is just some matrix which is diagonalizable on an orthogonal set. So you can look at, for example, the set of all matrices that are diagonalizable on this same orthogonal set. Right? So for example, you can do that. For example, consider. And we can consider the set of matrices which are diagonalizable on this special particular set. Okay, so what happens with this set? So this is an abelian Lie algebra. And so what is this? So what happens when you look at the orbit of your set O? This is simply the set of all inner products that make this set orthogonal. Okay, so there is something, there is some very easy computation that you can do, actually. If you restrict the metric of the symmetric space to this set, trivial computation tells you this is isometric to A. So in fact, but this is a little harder, is that this is actually a totally geodesic flat. So the intrinsic geometry is flat, right? Because it's just a vector space with some inner product. But the fact is it is geodesic, so it's actually an embedded flat. So. So maximal in dimension and geodesic is flat as flat. So so for example, what you get from this is the distance from O to E to the sum vector O is simply the sum of the eigenvalues T squared. Okay? But so what happens, for example, when you have some matrix like that? So this is one flat that's going through P and this tangent vector, right? This is just some flat there. But there are probably, maybe there are more flats that go through this point and this vector, right? So what could happen? So what did we do? So we picked T. We looked at the basis where it was diagonalizable, and matrices diagonalizable, inner products that make this special set orthogonal are the flats. It's a flat through. That goes through this point. So maybe there are more, because maybe T could be diagonalizable on several other bases. And the fact that T could be diagonalizable on many bases is saying that T has some coincidence on eigenvalues, right? So what are we going to do? We're going to consider the following. So if you take U and V on E, I'm going to consider the following function, linear function. The eigenvalue E on U minus the eigenvalue T on V. Okay, so if this is zero, then there are several flats through T, because this is diagonalizable on many bases that are contained in the vector space spanned by U and V, right? Okay, so this is a finite set of linear forms. So this finite set of linear forms is called the root system of A. Okay, so what do you have? You have A, and you have this finite set of linear form, and when the forms vanish, it's saying that there is some trouble in the vector. So you're going to look at all the possible kernels of all these possible linear forms. So if you have a vector that doesn't lie on any of them, means that there is only one flat through that point on that vector. Because it diagonalizes in only one, there are no coincidences in eigenvalues, so it diagonalizes on only one orthonormal set. So connected components of this complement that's called a Weyl chamber. It's picking one of these connected components. Okay, so now if you pick some Weyl chamber, just pick one, pick this one, for example. So this is picking one Weyl chamber is exactly the same as picking some order on the set E. So just fix one of them. some order, sorry. So now that we picked one, we can choose an order. So we want to write now we can write this as this. Yeah? And the bile chamber is going to be vectors such that all of these linear forms are positive. Which means that the vectors on A. Okay, so what happens now? So let me just recall for later that this special, now that we have this order, this special linear forms here are called the simple roots. Okay, so what happens when you have 2 points? Now we just studied what happens when you have a point and a vector. So what happens when you have 2 points in the symmetric space? You want to understand if there is some flat going through them. You have O and Q, say. So what do you have to do? So these are two inner products, and you want to find a set which is orthogonal for both. That's a flat through them. So if you're right, so it, so how do you do that? So we're going to write Q as some the image of some matrix times O. So the direction of the group is transitive. And so we have this matrix now, so we can look at this Cartan decomposition of the matrix with respect to O. So these two guys are okay. And this guy here is an element of the on the bile chamber. Okay, so which is now the orthogonal set? Who's gonna be now the orthogonal set, which is the set which is gonna be orthogonal for O and Q is gonna be simply the image of E by this guy. So this set of D lines is going to give you exactly the flat that's going to go through O and Q. Okay, so again, as before, there could be many flats through O and Q, and that depends on whether this guy has some coincidence on eigenvalues. Right? Because if this guy has some coincidence in eigenvalues, means that there are many choices of this vector, of this element. So what you're going to do, let me just write some definition. Let me write K of P as the stabilizer, K of the vector space P. So remember, we had a preferred basis here, and we had an order on it. And so let me write down. Consider the simple root. Well, let me put it this way. Consider the number P such that so this is telling me where there are no coincidences of the eigenvalues of A of G. And so let me just find this is a set. Let me just finally define K of theta as the intersection of all of these. Let me write this as depending on G, or better, depending on O and Q. Okay, so finally what's happening, what I'm saying is that any element any element
of k theta.
So all of these all of these sets are simultaneously orthogonal for O and Q. So this is telling me all the flats are going through O and Q. Okay, just for the record. So instead of considering the basis, we can stick with a little less information, which is called we're going to consider the flag. So this is a complete flag. Such that which is so I'm just considering the flag, which is this vector, then the sum of the first two, then the sum of the first three, et cetera, et cetera. Sorry? Yeah. Yes. Yes, this is telling me where I can jump. So this is defined up to the moment you jump, you can choose anyone. Sorry, right? So this is exactly saying. So you consider this complete flag, and so now what I'm going to do is, instead of considering all these bases, all these different bases, I'm going to consider the flag. So this was a complete flag, but this may kill some vectors. So this is now going to be some partial flag. Partial flag. So what is the interest of this partial flag? Because I'm going to think of this flag as a point at infinity in the symmetric space, for the flats that go through O and G O. So let me make this picture. So in some sense, what's going to happen is, if I look at flats that go from O and GO, if I look at not flats but Weyl cones, I mean, the image of the, instead of looking at the whole flat, I'm looking at the image of the Weyl chamber only. If I look at all these flats that go through O on this guy, they, in some sense, they're going to have this flag at infinity. They're going to share this flag at infinity, in the following sense. So let me write it this way. So this flag is going to be the flag which we're going to call U of G. We're going to call this flag U of G because exactly this flag is corresponding to where G has its biggest axis, as we had at the beginning. And so what I'm trying to say is that all these guys share this flag at infinity. So I'm not defining a boundary. I'm not looking at the visual boundary. I'm just saying we have to think about this in the following way. So when you in H2, for example, if you have a point inside and a point at infinity, you can have only one stochastic rate that's going associated to this two. So here you can do something very similar, which is if I have this flag, if I have a partial flag and a point inside, I can choose a whole family of flats that go through this point and at infinity go to the flag. This is simply what? I have my flag, I have my inner product, I apply Gram-Schmidt to this flag to obtain an orthogonal set, and then I complete this orthogonal set as I can with orthogonal sublines. This is going to be all the flats that's going from this point to the point at infinity. So this is actually very important, the fact that the flag at infinity that you get from O to GO is the biggest axis of the ellipse. Of how is the biggest axis of the ellipse when you look at the inner product O. So let me just say again a quick formula that follows from the Cartan decomposition, which is the distance from O to CO. This is going to be, if you apply the Cartan decomposition, they both stabilize O. So this is going to be exactly the norm of A of G. And this is going to be the square root of the sum of the log of the singular values. So when you have O to GO, this distance here is going to be something like the log of the norm of G for the inner product O. It's going to be comparable to that. So the distance from O to GO is what? It's the norm of the matrix with that inner product. And at infinity, what is the associated flag at infinity? Is the flag that explains you how the biggest axis of the image ellipse are done. So just one last statement, and we can actually state Kapowicz-Lipsz-Portis theorem. The following observation, which I personally like very much. So if you say now that you have two flags, A is some partial flag indexed on some numbers. Indexed on some numbers, pi, and you have some other flag in general position. Again, a partial flag. So they're in general position, are in general position. If when you take complementary spaces, they don't intersect. So now you can do something very similar to what we did now. So if we had a point and a flag at infinity, we could reconstruct the image of this Weyl chamber here. Simply by, so this is a flag with the inner product, you apply Gerber-Schmidt and you obtain an orthogonal set, and then you consider all set of lines that span these same sets at the same time. So now you have two flags. So what are you gonna do? They are in general position, so now when you consider, you can consider all inner products that make these two flags orthogonal. This is what's called a parallel set. All inner products. Okay. So this gives you some sort of set inside. It's a union of flats. Because you have some orthogonal set, and then you look at all the lines that span the same guys. And you look at orthogonal inner products and make these lines orthogonal. So this is a union of flats. So actually, using the order I had in my set, I can actually interpret as this as going somewhere, like starting here and going there. Okay. And okay, so what is the lemma I want to state for you is that if you have an inner product here, yes. And you want to understand what is this distance? So the statement is that this distance is what you're going to do. You have these two guys, right? So you have these two spaces which are complementary. You're going to measure their angle with this inner product. And you're going to take the smallest of that and the log of that. And this is this distance. So what do? You take the angle between E, pi, and F, D minus pi. You take the sinus. The log, you take the minus, you take the mean, take the minus, so you get something positive. And this is, the distance is going to be comparable to this. Comparable in the following sense, that you will have some numbers, some constant numbers, L and C. And the same on the other side. So if you want to understand the distance from this point O to this parallel set, of what you got to do is you got to see, you got to measure the angles of these two guys from this point, for this inner product. Okay. So what's the statement? So let me just state the simplest version of the statement. So yeah, otherwise we won't have time to do, to explain how the proof finishes. So what you do, you're going to consider some cone. Say that we have picked this one, for example. Consider some cone inside this vial chamber. You can't touch the walls, you don't know, it's just some cone in there. Right? Consider some quasi-geodesic. Let's make it by infinite, so to simplify the statement, but we can also get the other statements, stronger statements. So we're going to say that the quasi-geodesic is C regular. If what? If when I look at the Cartan, this Cartan projection from one point to the other, right? So this was what? This was. You pick a matrix that goes from here to here, and you look at its singular values. This is this vector. If this belongs to C. Okay, so you have this quasi-geodesic, and then, so this is saying something about the distance. So it goes further away in distance, comparable to n, for example. But also, the vectors that you get lie inside this some given cone. And this can be made coarsely, that's not a problem. So what's the statement? One of the statements. So if fix n is a C-regular quasi-geodesic, then what? There exists two flags, partial flags, in general position. So the type of these flags depends on where on the walls the cone intersects or not, such that xn is at bounded half of distance from the parallel set. Okay, so actually, it's the actual statement is a little bit stronger because you have this quasi-geodesic. You have this parallel set here, but actually, you can pick a point and you can look at the vial chamber that goes to infinity to this guy and to infinity to this guy. So this it's not actually the whole parallel set. You can look at some images of cones. So let me try to give you the proof that we found. So what you're going to do is you're going to consider sequences of matrices that explain you how this guy is moving. So say that you fix some O here, right? So you're going to consider Hn of O gives you Xn, and you're going to let Gn to be Hn plus 1 psi times G plus 1 times Gn, Hn. So what's going to happen is that the sequence of Gn, so these are all bounded, this is bounded, no. This guy has bounded norm, just because of the quasi-geodesic relation, these guys have bounded norm. bounded norm with respect to this O point here. And moreover, so what happens when you multiply them? So this is going to give you the map. When you multiply all of them, you multiply some fixed amount of them, sorry, from n to m, this is going to give you the map that goes from here to here. And this, the fact that this lies in the cone, and the fact that the norm is growing as my n minus m, because it's a quasi-Schottky basic, is going to tell you that you're going to have the exact same relations for the singular values that that depend on the for the walls that for the walls that doesn't intersect the cone C. So let me just write this. So this is very straight. This is very, very straightforward, which means that this is very straightforward. It's literally followed from the definition of a quasi-geodesic and being away from certain walls. And this holds for the P, right? Okay, so now let's go back to our usual, so to our first statement. We're going to build ourselves some cosicon and apply the dominated splitting condition. So it turns out that it's actually very strange that if you consider the set of sequences that have bounded norm from fixed sum norm and that verify that condition over there. So as long as you fix these constants, L, C, and lambda, this is some compact set. And you have the shift on this compact set because it's some set of sequences. So you're going to build a cocycle, which is just this set times V. And who's going to be your bounded automorphism? Just so this is a bundle automorphism, and by definition of the base, they verify Bucci-Wurm-Bellon's criterion. They have the hypothesis, and so it splits. So the Bucci-Wurm-Bellon criterion is saying exactly that, saying exactly what, when you look at this U vector, is it going to converge to something? Look at the complementary guy when you do it backwards. This is going to converge to something. This is the Bucci-Wurm-Bellon criterion. And they are in direct sum. So these are these, sorry. So in particular, so then the exam, and the base is compact. So in particular, the angle between these two guys is bounded below because the base is compact. So what's happening is have your O and your cosine is going through O. So when you look at this flat from O to XM, this is going to be some U of these guys. This is what we did at the beginning. And what you know is that this sequence is going to converge. And the same to the opposite, in the opposite direction. You know they're in the exam, and you know that the angle for them is bounded below by some constant independent of the sequence. Because this is this constant here. This is a base, this is a compact set. But the angle is just the distance from this point to this flat. So the fact that this, the fact that this distance doesn't depend, so you have a uniform bound that doesn't depend on the sequence that you picked, is going to tell you that if you pick some other sequence, some other point on the sequence, you can put it back here, you can put it back here, and look at this, what this distance is, and you're going to have the same distance on the other side. So this argument actually gives you, okay, you can get much stronger results as Kappa which Leopardi do. So for example, you only need the sequence to be long enough. You don't need to have a bi-infinite sequence. You just need it to be long enough, and then you have the same statement. And this is just this is again holds here because this conversion here was exponential in some sense. So you don't need the whole sequence. If you multiply enough matrices, this is going to be close to somewhere already. And the same here. Some easy contradiction argument gives you the direct sum afterwards. So let me just say one last word on what happens in the general for a general semi-simple group, because there is some non-trivial statement to be made. It doesn't follow exactly like this. So the idea will be the following. So the actual statement that's missing for a semi-simple group is this statement. What does this mean? Do you have a statement like this? This distance compared to these two guys over here. So what you're going to do? You're going to put your symmetric space into some other symmetric space of some matrices. So say you have X, G. Of some semi-simple group, non-compact type, et cetera, et cetera. So what you're going to do, you're going to consider some representation, for example, into SLD. Some irreducible representation, say, so that you get some totally geodesic embedding of the symmetric spaces. So you have some point here. So when you have these two flags at infinity in the symmetric space of G, they're going to go to partial flags. In the boundary of the symmetric space of SLV. So what you want to understand is the distance from your point O to this parallel set associated to these two partial flags. So the problem here is that you know how to do that in SLD, in SLV? It's just the angle from this here, from this guy. The problem is that the parallel set could be much bigger now. The parallel set in SLV associated to these two flags is much bigger than this. So maybe the distance is attained here. And this could be very far away. So this distance is going to be comparable to the angle between these two guys, but you don't know what happens to this distance. Okay, so there's something to show there that it actually remains bounded from this guy. So the actual statement is, when you consider some orthogonal vector here, it's going to make some fixed angle with the bigger parallel set. So this is going to give you the bound between these two distances here.
I think I'm going to stop here. Thank you.